You know where we are, of course, those of you who know where we are. But we're at the end of the Strand. This is the beginning of Imperial Beach. And as you know, this used to be like a, where you could put your RV, but it's going. It's going by the way of the dozer in this case, because what's coming in its place is a massive high-rise condo project. There's like 200 or 300 units, I believe. I'm not exactly sure, but remember these little slabs that you could pull up next to and have your trailer on? Well, gone. All gone. Going, going, gone. Little mini putting green was here. Little greenhouse over there. All going, going, gone. Morning! Maybe I can get the project construction manager to come and tell us what it's all about, what's going to be coming here. So TNT Blanchard 760, that must be North County. They're here to do the demolition. And this young man, hello young man, what's your name?
Brian.
Brian, so you're out of North County? I'm seeing by your area code there.
Temecula.
Temecula, yeah. So let's walk in here a little bit. I found something interesting about this. They're gonna take all of this. Well, you tell me what you're gonna do with this concrete, son.
We're gonna grind it up and use it to stabilize the bottom of the over excavation.
So you'll use that big machine over there, and it's got a grinder on it, right?
A crusher, yeah.
So you'll end up with like base.
Yeah, 3-inch minus.
Yeah. And then what happens? So you'll cover that all over the land?
Well, we're going to over-excavate it. We got to go down 5 feet and stabilize the bottom. Uh-huh. It all depends on what it looks like. There's a bunch of different steps we can take to stabilize the bottom before we can build houses on it.
Now, water table's only... What,
five feet? Well, 5 to 10 feet, it all depends on what time of day it is.
Of course, the tide rising, yeah. Right. So if the coolest company in the world to do this kind of work would be your company, I guess.
Yeah, we do quite a bit of this stuff.
Yeah? So we're giving you a little plug for your company.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about who runs that.
The owner's name is Barry Blanchard. He's been in business since the 70s.
Yeah.
Out of Temecula, Escondido area.
Right. Well, we'll give him a big plug. And is there anything else that we should know about this project?
We're doing as much recycling as possible. We're going to grind up these trees and try to use it as a...
Mulch. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, well, this concrete here has probably got a lot of steel in it, right?
Yeah. We're going to take the steel out and recycle the steel.
And how'd you do that? You just magnet?
Well, no, we actually have laborers that are going to come up and
pick it out, huh?
Yeah.
So it's like rebar, you mean?
It's rebar, yeah. So
yeah.
All the palm trees are all getting transplanted to another place. And,
that's fantastic.
There was a mobile home here. We donated that to a church.
Very cool.
There was a like a chipping green out
there.
Yeah,
I saw that.
And a driving net. We donated that to a church.
Very
also.
Cool.
As
cool.
Much as we can recycle and give back, we like to.
Very nice. So they're going to build what on here?
Condo.
Now, are you going to knock the wall down and do the other lot over there? Or?
No, that's something.
Something different.
Project.
It's got nothing to do with this.
Right.
Well, there you have it. All right, lad. Well, let's give a shout out to the name of your company again.
TNT Blanchard.
TNT Blanchard. Recycles, man. That's good, isn't it? Every little bit helps. And there you have it. Thanks, lad. Thanks for the interview.
Thank you.
So in addition to this, you weren't always this. You were like a pro bull rider, right?
Yes, sir. I rode professional rodeo. Went pro in 96 and had to stop in 08 because of a pretty bad injury. Traveled all over California and you know, Arizona, Nevada. I won Rookie of the Year for the California circuit in 97. I was top 50 the whole time I was riding. I was always top 50 in the world, but yeah, it was a passion.
And who wouldn't know that?
Yeah, you know, it was a...
You don't get like ex bull rider on you.
No. Yeah.
So you look like an ordinary guy, but you're not, are you?
No, I was raised in the cattle industry and cowboying and stuff.
Well, you got to be some kind of tough guy to do that bull riding, because those deers are, how big are they?
The bulls, they're in 2,000 pounds.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah.
You ever got your hand trapped under the rope like?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I've torn my bicep. I've broke my neck. I've had my left ear torn off. I mean, it was
almost no one gets out of there alive, kind of thing.
Well, no, I mean they make it.
No, I don't mean that, but I mean you get beat up.
You get beat up. Yeah. The bullfighters will help you out a lot too.
Yeah. Well, I'll be darned. Isn't that interesting? Now tell me this: do you miss it?
Oh, I miss it terribly.
But you know you couldn't do it anymore.
Well, I went back and rode one about 2 years ago. And since 08, I never climbed back on it. My wife was like, babe, I'd really like to see you ride. We went out to a bull ride in Escondido. And again, I haven't been on since 08. July 4th of 08 is when I got hurt up in Folsom. And I got on the bull and rode him like I was riding every day and jumped off, landing on my feet. And it was a good way to end it.
So tell me this. What made you decide that was the last time, just that last little bit of fun?
My age, you know, I'm getting older. I turned 40 this year, and you know,
how about that? I don't bounce. Old.
Well, for bull riding, it's old. You know.
Did you say I don't bounce?
I don't bounce like I used to. I kind of hit and stick now. So. I used to bounce.
Well, actually, a lot of people got mangled doing that. You know.
Oh yeah.
You know, a lot of lesser people who really couldn't do it, who shouldn't have been out there doing it, got stomped and thrown.
Really bad wrecks where just real inexperienced people would try, and I try to help as many people out as I can. You know, I give them the pointers and help them learn and do it the right way, and it helps some guys, and then some guys are just too cool to listen and thought they knew better.
Yeah.
And they get in a pretty bad wreck.
Well, a fellow was telling me down, he was at a rodeo in San Antonio, and this young cocky kid jumped up and, I mean, he really got smacked. No one saw it properly what happened until he came and sat down, and he had a hole right through there, and he died right there and then.
Yeah.
That's how tragic it can be.
Seen a lot of wrecks.
Were you one of those guys that had to wear a helmet? I see him wearing helmets these days.
I tried the helmet one time, I broke my jaw wearing the helmet because you kind of go into a zone. Once you nod and come out of the chute, you kind of just go into autopilot.
Yeah.
And for some reason with that helmet, I kind of focused on the bars, and so I couldn't see what was going on. And,
oh, you mean because of the guard?
Yeah, I just focused on it. Next thing I know, I hit the bull in the face, and then I was the end of that ride.
Hit the bull in the face, did you?
Yeah, but I broke my jaw. It had a titanium cage on it. It crushed that pretty good, so I threw it in my gear bag and never put it back on.
What could a fellow like you do similar to get such a rush?
I raced motocross, too.
Yeah? No, I mean, I'm talking about now with your injuries and you can't do it anymore. What are you going to do?
I still race motocross.
You do?
Yeah.
All right.
And, you know, I ride horses and water ski, wakeboard. I'm an adrenaline junkie, I guess.
So you just got back up on the horse, didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
Right away,
yeah. Yeah, you can't walk away down. Yeah. You got to get up on a higher note.
Good. Great interview, son. Thank you.